Today's speaker is Nikolai Vovchanskii, and he will present modern applications of Trotter formula for two stochastic processes and stochastic flows. Please.
Thank you for the introduction. However, we will have two lectures. The first one is devoted to the general explanation of what the Trotter formula or splitting of fractional step method is. And I think the second one is mostly supposed to be devoted, we cannot guarantee in such times, to applications and specifically to application in serious stochastic processes. So let me start from the beginning in the sense that what is the main idea? And we start with the simplest possibility to introduce this idea. The generally speaking, if you have a dynamical system, this is driven by some mechanisms and external forces, and we can decompose the action of these forces and the mechanisms into a set of such mechanisms. We can, instead of solving the PDE that describes the system, solve simpler PDEs that are driven by those subsystems. So if we have square matrices, we of course can define exponentials in a very standard way. So this is TA to the power n, and the same is true. This is a good defined series. And the simplest case of splitting is a theorem, very old result by Lee, that maybe even earlier, that you can do the following. The limit of such expression is just a plus b times t in any norm. And however, from this moment, I will suppose that we are dealing with the operator norm of a matrix. So, of course, the first remark that we need to understand that if AB are commuting, that is, this expression equals to zero, then effectively this formula is exact. So the right half side and the left half side are equal immediately. However, in general, this is not true. Let's have a look at the proof of this result, because we will need to discuss the proof and its extensions. There is a very simple but extremely widely used algebraic lemma that if you have such expression, you can actually rewrite it in the following way. And minus y minus k. This is an algebraic result. The proof is simple, so we will skip that. Now going to the proof of the theorem, let us define Tn and Sn. So here we assume for simplicity that T is just one. Then we have two steps. The first step is if you look at the norm of this difference, it's less than by the lemma. And here stands maximum of SF Tn after taking norm to the power n minus 1. And this is, of course, less than just n Sn minus Tn, this expression. So we have n summons, and this is the difference at one step. Now, the second step is that we need to consider literally okay, series Sn. We have a Sn is a product and after some algebraic transformation, we will arrive at a simpler expression. But essentially, we will need to use a standard decomposition of the exponential. Tc plus t squared c squared plus O capital from this. And this is n minus 2. Commutator divided by 2 or something. Now combining the first step and the second step, we will arrive at the conclusion. This is n minus 1 a b commutator. But something of order n to the power minus 2. So as we see, this is an algebraic result. And what we are after in this set of lecture is the corollary, effectively. So suppose that we are given the following ordinary differential equation is good, just with constant coefficients. Then the decomposition we have mentioned is as follows. We consider two simpler expressions. Here zero is given, and here also is given. And then we know in this case, literally the exact formula for the solution. And our the Lie formula says that this converges to the solution and it goes to zero of the original equations. That means the following. We can consider intervals of size IH is given n minus 1 times t. And here we solve the first subsystem. Here we solve second subsystem. Again, first, again, second. And in this is the transformation that defines the approximation of the solution. So every force A and B acts on the time interval of length T. However, they're interchanging in their nature. So this is, we will refer to this one step of splitting. And when saying splitting and the leaf formula, we need to understand what is the difference or whether the difference even exists. So let's start a bit about terminology that we are going to follow. And also getting people offended very easily, because people care about naming things. So we already see the Lie formula. However, this is also this is usually reserved for the finite dimensional case. Theoretists working in the field of group theory prefer the Trotter-Kato, sometimes Lie formula. Sometimes they add product here. For this reason, I was also told that Dalesky was involved and has results about this method. I suppose it's true. However, I haven't seen much usage of his name. This is effectively the same what happened with the celebrated EM algorithm in the machine learning. There are two guys who are usually referred as the authors. However, Vorontsov writes that one Soviet Ukrainian mathematician was the first guy to propose the method. But again, nobody uses his name. And this is a good example for me because I attended the lectures of this person when I was a student. Now, another way to refer to this idea is splitting. More precisely, multiplicative splitting, because there is also additive splitting. We will speak very briefly about it at the end of the lecture. Splitting, you can find fractional step method, Marchenko, Yanenko scheme, etc. Practitioners in different fields usually may speak not in terms of these general words, but in terms of specific versions of the algorithms that are present in their field. I will be using the Trotter-Kato formula because this is what usually theorists prefer. However, this is not always true, and I will be using splitting. Because in fact, Zygas dictates this is a very good name. Now we can return to mathematics. If you look at this decomposition, this is immediately not the only way to do decomposition. So there are other methods as well. We will need this standard is first order accurate, as we seen. However, what is interesting, we can modify the idea to obtain schemes of the second order. So they converge quickly. The first is strang. Sometimes it's also referred to as strang-Lie splitting. And in this case, you use three substeps, subsystems. And this also converges. This is also an algebraic result for matrices. And goes to infinity. There is also symmetrical versions, where you do the following plus TB. Because generally speaking, splitting is not a symmetrical operation. It depends on how operators are arranged. Times two. This is also second order. There are schemes of higher orders. However, they come with more complicated they are more complicated from a practical point of view. So let this be a standard, simple step, then something like this works, or something like here, gamma s, sense to gamma, n minus 1, s, n minus 1. And in this version, this is negative, so we are solving a problem backwards in time. Sometimes it's not possible in general settings. Whether the scheme is used or not heavily depends on the field and preferences and knowledge specific to the field. Now, if you look at the original formulation, it is formulated for bounded operators. However, when we speak about PDEs, the operators are unbounded immediately. And we want this idea to work in a general abstract setting. For that, we need to arrange a stage. So we start with a motivating example. In this case, the method is exact. That is, recover the original solution. And the example is just the heat equation, dimension 2. And the splitting we are going to be after. It's just this, d over dt. And d over dy squared. So effectively, from the physical point of view, we allow heat to propagate firstly in x direction, then in y direction, then we iterate. So of course, in this case, there is these two operators, ax and ay, are bounded, so we cannot easily define this series. However, I will use this notation to denote a solution to this subsystem. Again, it's a standard notation. However, we need to understand this is not a series. The series cannot be defined because there is no norm for this thing. So it's just a notation. And now if GT is just one-dimensional Gaussian density with zero mean and variance t, then we can actually write the solution gt x minus a v zero a y d a, and w x y t is just the integral gt y minus b w zero x b db. So this splitting procedure, if we iterate solving these subsystems and repeating that exactly n times, that is the power and acting on some initial condition, this just r to n g n t minus 1 x minus n t minus 1 a n minus a n minus 1 n t minus 1 a 2 minus a 1, exactly the same expression. For the direction x, y, I'm sorry, b2 minus b1. And here's the initial condition, g0, a1, b1, dA1, dAn, TB1, TBN. And then we can convolute everything and just recover the region, a proper solution, the regional one. One can check this is true. So the operator is unbounded, but the method works. This is an example of a locally one-dimensional method. This is also the name you can find in literature. So now let's formulate the abstract Cauchy problem. We will not be paying much attention to details in the sense that we just want to have a possibility to consider such things at direction, diffusion reaction systems, since this is a place where splitting methods are actively used to obtain numerical solutions. And that is effectively PD of this form, divergence sub D gradient of U minus divergence here just multiplication plus R. So this is diffusion part. This is what happens to particles that are thrown into some fluid under the action of velocity fields that are present, currents that are present in the fluid, and this is source. Of course, people may write it in divergence free form, but I wrote in this form to make clear that if you write it in divergence free form, this free term will also reflect something from velocity, which is interesting. Not immediately clear for not a physicist. Now, if X is a Banach space and we have some linear operator, and it suppose that it generates a C0 semigroup. So the C0 semigroup is a collection of bounded linear operators that such that this is a semigroup and it's strongly continuous in the sense that T plus S converges T S when S goes to zero for every, for every X, for every point it's this Banach space. And the example that X is just L2 R squared. And then we have the heat stem group, as in the previous result. So the heat stem group just acts on function f from L2. It can be defined on L2 as symmetrical representation f x plus psi of t, where psi of t solves the stochastic differential equation. In our case, it's just dwt. Now, abstract Cauchy problem is written as follows: dt ut plus f of t and u at zero. There are slightly different formulations that may be encountered. We are stuck with this one. So, a classical solution. Classical solution is a function. Is it differentiable? Differentiable x valued a function u of t such that u of t allows to act to have this term and this one holds. There are other solutions people usually consider, mild solution or entropy solution for a reason. And the reason for that we'll discuss also. Now, in terms of semigroups, the solution to this thing is known. directly. Differentiability means in ordinary sense, not a Gattaz sense, for sure, just ordinary sense. And this is also abstract question of the Lebesgue integral. So this is Lebesgue integral, but for the functions it takes values in some Banach space. This is called Bochner integral in this case. Again, the example can be written in terms of the previous one. We need to make a remark that if you take a modern textbook on PDEs, people tend to use another formulation. They used to speak, they are more inclined to speak in terms of weak, which is variational solution, and use so-called energy estimates. It uses the Lex-Milgram theorem for one main reason, because it allows to introduce the Galerkin approximations, that is the finite element method, to obtain a numerical solution, to obtain the solution numerically. This is the main point of this theory if it's aiming at practitioners in the field. That is because, generally speaking, for practitioners, for people who want to obtain a solution, this formula is not always helpful. And I'm also mentioning this because the next lecture will provide some examples where people are doing, in the stochastic setting, some things that are very reminiscent of that approach. Now we are ready to formalize the Trotter-Lie-Kato formula in this abstract setting. So let we have AB generates C0 semigroups. I will denote those semigroups AT e to the power t times A1, A to the power A2. Again, this is just annotation. We also suppose that these semigroups are contractions, so they are controllable, and this is usually called the stability condition. And we suppose that A can be decomposed on core of A, and core is just a substantial domain in the sense that it defines the operator. Then for any X, converges because this is by definition just this expression. The convention uniform locally in T. This is strong convergence. And I want also to present a result from a paper of Butko. That generalizes this in some specific way. More precisely, we have C0 semigroup, and A is its generator. And we suppose that A can be decomposed as a sum. And of course, we never spoke about this, but this idea works also when you have not two summons in this decomposition, but a finite number that is greater than two. And suppose that we have this decomposition, this internal decomposition of that is written in terms of bounded linear operators, such that this family, again, linear bounded operators that are almost semigroup, almost contraction semigroups, in the sense that they lack the semigroup property. They are controllable for some AK. They start at zero, and FK of TX minus X divided of T converges to AK of X on cot of A. Then the following analog F1 TN FM TN repeated n times x converges to this initial semigroup. Here, these operators may be bad in the sense they are not supposed to generate linear bounded, generate C0 semigroups. And from the point of practitioners, this is a very important thing because a decomposition of A is often dictated in practice by the availability of software to solve the problems, of availability and good properties of solvers for those subsystems. And now people can take subsystems as they want. There is one thing about all these proofs, and we need to talk about this. This is strong convergence, but we didn't say anything about the speed of the convergence in contrast to the case of finite dimensional matrices. And this is because you cannot get those bounds. Let's speak a bit about this because, again, this is important. If you have something that A is aimed at discretizing or providing an approximation procedure, and you cannot say anything about the speed of this convergence, it may not be that beneficial. First of all, we need to understand that since all operators are generally speaking bounded, the previous proof fails. So a very standard way to obtain this formula is obtained as a result of the Chernov theorem. The Chernov theorem may be formulated that you need, again, a family of contractions, so literal bounded linear operators whose norms are less than or equal to one. They also satisfy this property. A generates C0 semigroup. And for any, again, F of a sufficiently large set, we can recover the action of this generator. Then if you do this, you have your convergence. This is called the Chernov approximation of the initial semigroup. Now it's pretty clear to obtain the Trotter-Lie-Kato formula. So remark, of course, we are skipping all the details that are usually present in the case of finite of infinite dimensional operators. That is, you need to control domains when you do this and so on. So this leads to the Trotter-Lie-Kato formula. Let's try to understand why we cannot recover, generally speaking, the speed of convergence. There is a simplema for that, in the sense that if B is a contraction, such that all powers are bounded, then we have this nice possibility to approximate it. The proof is actually almost one liner, and again it's an algebraic result at heart. So you just minus SN.
Well, excuse me. And
yes?
What is the relation between B and S?
B and S. B and S. Well, there is no. Yes, I suppose there is no B at all. I'm sorry.
Okay, of course.
Yeah, it would be strange. Yeah, of course, you just approximate the exponential with the power. Thank you. So this can be rewrite it as a telescopic sum. And that leads it this expression, I will denote it I. The norm of this expression can be approximated as M and here we are going to have what is left. So this is NKK because this telescopic sum is going to have N minus K summons. Now using the Cauchy inequality, we can have this for 1/2. And this is variance of a Poissonian random variable. It's parameter n. So this is the reason why I wanted to consider this proof, because it introduces at last some probability right now. So we have this estimate. And now if you look at the proof of the Chernoff theorem. The idea that you introduce bounded linear operators. And those are for any x on a sufficiently large subset, you have this by our assumption. And there is a general theory that says that then the semigroups are strongly convergent. This is also the Trotter-Kato theorems. There are variations of this result. And this is where we lose, generally speaking, our speed of convergence. I will leave an exercise to finish the proof, starting from the point and using this lemma. But generally speaking, there is no possibility to have a general result that describes the speed. So, of course, this is not the only way, but again, this is a problematic for people who work. So, generally speaking, I will be repeating that a lot, and I have been repeating that a lot. People need additional things to obtain estimates of the speed of convergence. So let's speak a bit about obtaining those estimates as a general principle that if you have stability and you have consistency, you can derive convergence. So if you look at the formulation of the Chernoff theorem, that you have something like this, there were a family of contraction. That is stability, that our approximation doesn't propagate, doesn't enlarge, doesn't magnify the error if you use it repeatedly. This is called stability. And in some sense, we have, sorry, kax plus x, which is in some sense atx. So it means that for small t, that is called consistency. However, whether this is expected to get the convergence of the approximation method, this is not expected to give any bounds. So to have bounds, to have estimates, you will need a stronger notion of consistency. Ftx minus sums, so you need something of this form. Again, for p that is strongly, then I actually think one, you will need that. And of course, this should hold only for small t. And then you can actually go back to the proof of the Lie formula and try to mimic it in some sense. And this part is important for us because the next lecture will provide some examples when people in stochastic setting again trying to use the splitting procedure will use exactly this approach. They will derive stability estimates, and they will derive, including myself and my co-author, and they will derive this consistency estimates. Now we still have time. Good. So on practice versus theory, there is a big, there is actually a gap between those two things here. Because if you look at practical applications, this is numerically obtained solutions to PDEs. The literature is vast. Like, you can get lost immediately after you start. This may be the description of porous media, this may be fluids, gases, quantum physics, even the Navier-Stokes equation can be solved. People are using this idea to solve Navier-Stokes equations, advection diffusion reaction systems. Etc. And when working with numerically obtained solution, you need to take into account what solvers are available and what methods are developed in the field. And of course, since it's 2022, the number of methods developed in every specific field is huge. And people usually will refer to those methods by their names. And to obtain something like consistency, they will use very, very different methods that will strongly depend on the field. This is exactly why I mentioned those weak variational formulations, because people may not use a classical definition of the definition of a classical solution to the abstract Cauchy problems. They may use another definitions that allow them to prove something like this and obtain the estimate. Moreover, you can find a lot of papers written by physicists or applied mathematicians where there is no strong proof of the convergence, and people are trying to guess what this rate should be, at least in the situations they're interested in. So let us write once more what is the algorithm. And then we will speak a little about theoretical things that can be achieved on this way. So we have abstract Cauchy problem. Usually it is written in this form. So A in the left hand side. And also people usually write direct straight derivatives. And we suppose those A can be decomposed. So the decomposition is dictated by the availability of efficient solvers. And generally speaking, these operators in practice maybe as bad as you want. For instance, they may be, maybe even some differentials of some convex functions, that is, they may be multivalued. They may be non-linear, there are results in that case too. Now, suppose that t is fixed. We can define tn, which is t kn. So the step of the discretization is at minus one. And in real life situation, of course, the step cannot be too small. Now for t divided by h, we do as follows. We solve PDEs for subsystems. Or they may not actually be PDEs, they may be optimization problems or something like that. Okay, this is dk, dk, or dk, dk plus one. So we solve them one by one. K zero, dk, the initial condition is dictated by the value or by the value of a solution to the previous problem at the end of the interval. And the initialization is just the initial condition. This is tk. And utk plus one. So this is what we are after. This is u. K at the end of the interval. Generally speaking, it doesn't recover the trajectory of the solution. It recovers the value of the solution at specific points. Now let's speak a bit about extensions of the whole idea. Because the idea is to decompose the main operator, the operator that describes the system. You didn't. So we start with example, which is actually just the ESD. Suppose you have the stochastic differential equation with as good coefficients as you want. And the classical Euler Maruyama scheme reads as follows. You will need a sequence of independent, identical
distributions.
Thank you very much. Identical, suppose they are also Gaussian, and then you have C0 is the initial, and the step is n times t plus sigma psi k tn square root eta k. So this, we do this, and then we can write our solution as a c. So this is a very well known scheme. It's weakly convergent of order one. It's strongly convergent in O2 of this order 1/2. It's convergent almost surely on the whole interval this order, with any order that is less than 1/2. If coefficients are good, it's not, if coefficients are at least slightly bad things might happen. So this is not a splitting by itself. However, this is still the Chernow approximation. So you can define a family FT of contractions. In this case, this is just RT greater than zero, integrals, integral operators with respect to the Gaussian density with fixed coefficients. In the way that for any good function sufficiently small, we have which is a f a plus b a t n plus sigma of a t n okay. When a equals k.
And Banach space is a Banach space of bounded functions with supremum norm, because you speak about contraction.
I think we may not need a bounded function. We may go with smoother function.
Maybe continuous functions.
Yes, I think continuous, maybe even continuous at vanishing infinity. Of course, this is also a contraction. This is the integral. It's always a contraction. But I suspect that to make everything work rigorously, you will need to take a slightly smaller set. Well, not a slightly, a smaller set. But then we will actually will be in the setting of the Chernoff theorem, and we can use this repeatedly, the section of this family, not a semigroup, generally speaking. This is not a semigroup. And obtain our Euler approximation. Moreover, we can modify the Euler-Maruyama scheme and preserve the speed of convergence for good enough coefficients and even for bad coefficients in the way I am going to write. And have splitting. So this was done in one paper. Actually, it wasn't done in one paper. It's done in a number of papers to mitigate the behavior of a bad drift, of a slightly misbehaved drift. People weren't able to get estimates they wanted in the case of the drift they had, and they introduced a different scheme for which those estimates were obtainable. And they consider this decomposition. So they separated drift and the purely stochastic part. This is not an explicit equation. This needs to be solved. This is exactly what is backward Euler method is. And now this is directly the splitting procedure, like immediately. And it worked. And this is an example of a general approach that subproblems that appear may be solved as follows. So you have this subproblem, dt. A UK J to zero, and you use this backward Euler method, that is K J plus one minus UK J sorry. K, J power T K plus one equals zero. Now, if A is good enough, the solution is usually written h, our discretization step, minus half to the inverse of this expression, kg. And this is null because it's taken from the previous subproblems. Now we have the modification of the Trotter-Lie-Kato formula. So Tn a1 to the power minus 1 a2 minus t over n a m. This is repeated n times, and this is strong. This expression is strongly convergent to the solution. And this idea of using, of exploiting the possibilities of the solvers to subproblems lead to vast field of additive splitting that needs to be mentioned at least. Since it's really widely used by people, mostly in practice, in image processing, there are proposed algorithms. It can be applied to analysis of sparse data and optimization of sparse data, and it can be used for PDEs. It's also usually called alternating direction implicit ID methods. So we'll just consider one possible scheme, Pitchman-Rutherford. And there is also a very popular Douglas-Rutherford, which is similar, but different. Generally speaking, if operators for subproblems are commuting, they are second order accurate. Generally speaking, they are first order accurate, both of them. It's not very great in practice. So again, we have our abstract Cauchy problem. We know that this decomposition is possible. I will write it even this inhomogeneous coefficients. We never touched this topic, but all this idea of the Trotter formula may be realized also when you have dependence on time in your operator.
So operators A1 and A2 depend on time.
Yes, so this operators, well, it can, thank you very much, I've spoken in the wrong way. It can be also true that they depend on time. But now I suppose that they take time as, well, this is the dependence of time. So effectively this means something like this. I will write it in the form that T is an argument for A1. And additive splitting, I will need to consult my notebook, always mix them. So the idea is use backward Euler method for A1, forward Euler method for A2, then change the order of A2 and 1, and this is going to give us one step of splitting. More precisely, this means that the kth step of splitting is as follows. You start with the value of your approximation to the original function at times tk. You move to some additional function, and only then you recover your approximation. Of course, this is not a true value of the function, this is approximation. I'm just not writing waves. And you solve tn h over 2 plus a1 k at times tk plus h over 2 plus a2. And here we use the second available data, tk 0. And the second component, the second half of the step is t k plus 1 minus t 1 k divided by 2. And here you, since this is now forward, you don't even need to change it. Of course, this is aimed at numerical solutions only. There is a very developed deep theory for such ways, for such things. A whole world. So there is additive splitting, and there are a lot of results for that, often in terms of semigroup approach, and there is a lot of results for the additive splitting and related to them problems, because even the method of Lagrange, of multiplying Lagrange, of Lagrange multipliers can be, in some cases, be rewritten in this form. So in fact, we are almost done for this part of the lecture. The only thing I wanted to say is that we, in the last part of the lecture, we are concentrating on practical questions. However, the theory can take from the splitting method also quite a lot. Those are existence theorems, those are comparison theorems. There is a whole rough path theory developed for splitting, where I'm not really familiar with it. And you have obtained bounds, as in the result I mentioned. And some applications of the splitting procedure, multiplicative splitting procedure, in the stochastic setting will be presented next time. Thank you very much. This is all what I planned.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe somebody have questions or comments, please.
I have a question. And why do people consider these backward procedures? Because of speed of approximation, or there is another reason?
The reason is that to put it simply and quick, the reason is that usually it behaves better than the explicit method when you can, the forward method. It works better in terms of stability. So yes, for many, many cases, it's just better from the numerical point of view. However, I am not sure I can explain the idea why it does work better.
Okay, some other questions, please. If there are no questions, then we will wait for the continuation of this topic. And today we finish our work. See you next week. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.